To be honest, the most important kind of chromaticism happens with modulation. In the last video, I talked about an example from Johann Kernberger's book that demonstrated how a piece might be structured with modulation. In this example, each of the new keys was preceded by a new dominant. These were mostly created by a chromatic pitch, a leading tone in the new key. For example, the key change from C major to G major involved adding an F sharp to the D chord right before the key change. The one exception to this practice was found in the modulation from E minor to F major. In that case, the dominant chord was a C major chord that was already diatonic in E minor. So Kernberger added a B flat to the C chord, making it a dominant seventh. This chromatic makes the modulation more obvious. Perhaps the easiest way to modulate is to go to closely related keys, like C major moving to G major. This kind of modulation keeps most of the chords in common between the keys, and allows the modulation to occur with the addition of a single chromatic pitch. Some modulations are not so simple. Take a look at this example from a Beethoven bagatelle. In this case, the keys of F major and D major are not closely related. Three chromatic pitches are needed to change from one key to the other. This means that the two keys have no chords in common. This kind of modulation is sometimes called a phrase modulation, because it often occurs at the beginnings of phrases, or it might be called a direct modulation. It produces a more abrupt and dramatic modulation. Modulation may be based on a change of mode rather than a change of tonic. Here's an example from Franz Schubert. The theme is presented in C minor at the beginning, letter A. Then it's mirrored in the relative major, E flat major. Since the key signature is the same for both, no accidentals are necessary to accomplish this modulation. Later in the piece, at letter B, the theme is stated in C major and then in C minor. This requires changing C major's E natural and A natural to E flat and A flat to transform the theme into the minor key. Notice that neither of these modulations requires a new leading tone, nor a new dominant directly before the modulation. Modulations generally take a little bit of time to be effective, usually a couple of measures. More transitory chromatic effects can be achieved with single chords. The most common of these chords is what music theorist Walter Piston called the secondary dominant. The idea is that a new leading tone and the dominant chord that goes with it is created, and that this chord leads into any chord that's not tonic. The chromatic doesn't stick, and the pitches revert to diatonic ones after just one chord. I demonstrated some of the secondary dominants of the subdominant, 5 of 4s, in the Beethoven dances from the last video. A similar effect may be created by building a diminished chord on a new leading tone. It may be a diminished triad or a fully diminished seventh chord. Here's an example from Tchaikovsky's Sixth Symphony. Some theorists call secondary dominants or secondary fully diminished seventh chords temporary modulations or tonicizations. To me, these terms don't really describe the effect of the chords. The secondary dominant doesn't really make the next chord sound like a tonic. It just adds emphasis, an extra stress sliding into the next chord. Another reason I don't like the term tonicization is that there are a whole class of other chords that work just like secondary dominants, but that music theorists don't think of as tonicizations. These chords are called augmented sixth chords. just like secondary dominants. They add a leading tone to a chord in order to emphasize the chord that follows, which is usually a dominant chord. Here is an augmented sixth chord, a so-called French sixth, in C minor, in second inversion. This is much like a 5-7 of 5. It's created with the use of a single chromatic, but in a minor key, it does not have a dominant seventh quality, because the minor key signature causes it to have a lowered fifth. So it can be thought of as a 5-7 of 5 with a flat 5, or you can just call it a French sixth. A secondary leading tone triad in minor produces a similar chord. Notice that it's actually not really diminished. There's a strange interval between the top and bottom notes. Since the chord is in first inversion, the interval between the top and bottom notes is a sixth, an augmented sixth, hence the name augmented sixth chord. This interval might seem to be very exotic, but it's created automatically in minor keys when a secondary leading tone to the dominant is added. This chord is also known as an Italian sixth chord. Here's an Italian in first inversion from a Beethoven sonata. Here's a seventh chord built on a secondary leading tone in minor. It's an augmented sixth chord with an added seventh, known as a German sixth. While music theory teachers make a big deal out of these chords, they are not, in fact, important to the structure of a piece. They are mostly cosmetic. By cosmetic, I mean that these chords draw attention to certain aspects of the music, rather than actually shaping the music itself. They're like cosmetics that people use, that draw attention to certain aspects of the face, rather than actually being part of that face. That doesn't mean that they can't be really dramatic. Here's a German sixth chord used at the beginning of the last movement of Mahler's First Symphony. These chords can be relatively easy to understand in minor keys, but can seem complex in major ones. Music theory teachers have lots of tips and techniques to help their students understand how to use these chords in major keys, but perhaps the best way to think of them is that if they're used in major keys, they're actually borrowed from the minor. The idea of borrowing chords from major to minor, or vice versa, is so common that many music theorists think of major and minor as a single mode, where chords from either mode may be used freely. It's possible to borrow chords from other modes as well. The most common of these is built on a major flat 2, and it's borrowed from Phrygian. It's known as a Neapolitan. Here's a Neapolitan used by Beethoven in the Tempest Sonata. There's a similar chord that's often used in jazz that's known as a tritone substitution. To create a tritone substitution, you find a dominant seventh chord that is a tritone away from the standard dominant. So for example, if you're in the key of C, the standard dominant is G7, so you would use a D-flat 7 to move to C. The idea that chords can be chromatically altered and borrowed from other modes opens up a wide variety of harmonic choices for composers, and can lead to some striking effects. Mendelssohn borrows two chords from E minor at the beginning of the melody of his famous Wedding March. This allows the opening note of the melody to be harmonized with a half-diminished chord, a strange and dramatic choice. This is a long way from the three-chord method of harmonization discussed in the last video.